Welcome to USC Ideas and Actions, the official University of Southern California podcast. Shows a webcast live on Facebook from Studio 1A in the USC Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Yannis Yortsos, and I am the Dean of the USC Viterbi School of Engineering. It's a truly an honor and a pleasure to be with you tonight. You're in for a real treat. Thanks to the generosity of Universal Pictures, we're holding an advanced screening of First Man, which focuses on Neil Armstrong and the riveting story behind the first manned mission to the moon. I don't know if you know that, but Neil Armstrong, after he went to the moon and returned to Earth, realized that he has not done something important, which is getting a degree from USC. So he enrolled at USC to finish a master's in aerospace engineering, and think about this great honor for the school. In fact, in the Epstein Plaza, which is in front of our buildings in the engineering quad, we have a statue of Neil Armstrong. So any of you or that wants to drop by and see it and take a picture, it would be a wonderful thing to do. Before the showing of First Man, we're going to have a discussion with three remarkable individuals who have made singular contributions to our understanding of the final frontier. Our distinguished panelists have deep ties to USC Viterbi, whose roots in the aerospace industry, especially Southern California, stretches back many decades. With us tonight are Dr. Wanda Austin, USC's new interim president, and a USC Viterbi alumna. Dr. Austin is the former president and CEO of the Aerospace Corporation, a national leader in space innovation, and the leading architect for the country's national security programs. A member of the National Academy of Engineering, Dr. Austin served on the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology until January 2007. Joining Dr. Austin is Charles Bolden, also an alumnus of USC. Charles served as the Chief Administrator of NASA from 2009 to 2017, the crowning achievement of a nearly four-decade career at the agency. An experienced NASA astronaut, Mr. Bolden logged more than 680 hours in space, including successfully deploying the Hubble Space Telescope while on the Space Shuttle Discovery in 1990. He also rejoined recently the USC Board of Trustees. We also have with us Dr. Garrett Reisman, a new faculty member in our Department of Astronautical Engineering at USC. Dr. Reisman formerly served as Director of Space Operations at the company SpaceX. As a NASA astronaut, Garrett participated in three space shuttle missions and spent 3 months on the International Space Station. NASA recognized him by awarding him with the Distinguished Service Medal and the Space Flight Medal. Finally, moderating tonight's discussion is Anita Sengupta, who holds two advanced degrees from USC Viterbi in aerospace engineering and is also an adjunct professor, research associate professor of astronautics. She is currently the senior vice president of Hyperloop One and has served as the project manager of the Coal Atom Laboratory at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory at Caltech. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our distinguished guest and our distinguished moderator.
Thank you, everyone, so much for coming out this evening, and it is an absolute honor to be on the stage with this panel of space experts, and I think it's an honor for all of us in this room, and it's actually a historic event that we're going to watch this movie together of the first human being on the moon. So I have, you know, shivers and tingles as I am able to present this panel. And so the movie that we're going to see this evening will talk about, you know, the history that led up to the Apollo missions, the 10 years prior, and the specific journey of Neil Armstrong, our very historic alumnus of our university. So we put together a set of questions that we're going to ask our three distinguished panelists, and I think we're going to have an amazing conversation before we're able to watch the movie this evening. So the very first question is to all the panelists, and which is, what is the role that Apollo, and specifically Apollo 11, had in defining your career paths, and how did that affect your view of your place in the universe?
So I guess I'm sitting here, so I'm first. Okay. Actually, Apollo played, and I'll, this is not tongue-in-cheek, it actually played almost no role in my career as it developed, because I'm actually a person who never dreamed of going to space, never dreamed of being an astronaut, and at the time that I finally decided that I would apply for the space program, I was serving as a Marine Corps test pilot at the Naval Air Test Center in Patuxent River, Maryland, and I met an incredible human being by the name of Dr. Ron McNair, I call him the late, great Dr. Ron McNair. And we grew up about 42 miles from each other, did not know each other prior to that, and I was mesmerized by talking to him, and he asked me before he went back to Houston if I was going to apply for the space program. I told him, not on your life. And he kind of looked at me strange. He said, why not? I said, they'd never pick me. And he looked at me again and looked me right in the eye. He said, you know, that's the dumbest thing I ever heard. He said, how do you know if you don't ask? So he reminded me of what my mom and dad had told me as I was growing up in South Carolina, and I picked up pen and paper and applied. So indirectly, since Apollo had a big role in his going there, it affected my eventually becoming an astronaut.
Thanks, Anita. And I just want to say it's a pleasure to look out and see all of these Trojans in the audience, and really delighted that you're all here tonight. So fight on. This is fantastic. So I grew up in the 60s, a young black female in the inner city, and my parents told me that education was going to be the key to my success. And they were obviously impacted by the decision that President Kennedy made that said, you know, we're going to go put a man on the moon. And as a result, there was a focus on science and technology and the possibilities that made education really important, and it enabled me to actually get bused to a good school district where I would get a solid math and science foundation. So while it wasn't Neil Armstrong walking on the moon that motivated me specifically, it was the fact that the United States was on a mission and the focus of making sure that it remained great in terms of science and technology and innovation that enabled me to pursue a wonderful education that then opened subsequent doors for me. So that's the impact that it's had on my life. Garrett?
Well, like Charlie, I also, when I was a young man, I didn't think I was going to grow up to be an astronaut either, mostly because I had a mom that was, like, scared of flying. And when I was, like, on airliners, right? You know, I'm not talking about, like, being a test pilot in the Marines. I'm talking about, like United. So I didn't think that that was in the cards for me. I was not going to go off and become a test pilot. She would never let me. But I was fascinated by it. I was fascinated by space. I was always into math and science. I never thought I'd be an astronaut, but I was really gripped by the whole space flight bug. And so I had a movie of Apollo 8, and this will date myself. It was a Super 8. You kids out there, you don't know what the Super 8 movie was, but these are like old. There was actually like film. It wasn't a file, all right. It was like film on a reel, and the thing was notoriously unreliable. It would break all the time, so I had to keep splicing the film together to get it to keep playing. I watched it over and over and over so many times that the weight of the tape on the reel that I used to repair it was greater than the weight of the film, and I was just I could watch the LEM dock to the command of the service module all day long. I just absolutely loved it. And so it definitely inspired me, even if I didn't know where it was leading.
Incredibly inspirational. And I think I would also point out that a lot of the data that was collected in the development of the Apollo missions is still used to the present day in terms of designing things like landing engines for missions which do robotically will go back to the moon and go to Mars, and hopefully one day we'll send people there. But I think it would be really wonderful to hear, Charlie and Garrett, your experiences on how Neil Armstrong has actually affected your lives and his story.
You want to start?
Okay, so the first time I met him, it was when I just became an astronaut. And this is a total I'm not worthy moment, because we're all sitting there, brand new astronauts. We haven't done anything yet. And but every year we go back to have our physical, because they're still taking data on all of us. And so Neil Armstrong would go back once a year. And when he would go back, he would ask, do we have a new crop of astronauts? And if we do, he would offer to talk to us. So he offered to speak to my astronaut class, and we were sitting there, and he walked in, and he gave us this big, long presentation all about the X-15. Because I think that he thought of the X-15 and his technical contributions to that program. I think in some ways he viewed that as the pinnacle of his career, because of how involved he was in the development of the flight control algorithms for that vehicle. So he came and talked to us all about that, and he didn't say a word about Apollo, not a single word. And at the end, one of my classmates, who's a young, starry-eyed, it wasn't me, kind of dreamer, asked, hey, I got to ask you, when you were seeing the moon getting bigger and bigger in the window and the Earth only the size of your thumb getting smaller and smaller, what was going through your mind? And he gave what I thought was a really quintessential Neil Armstrong answer, which was, well, at that moment, we had completed the transposition and docking maneuver, and the TLI burn was done in ascent, so I could take all those checklists and chuck them. I wasn't going to have to worry about any of that. All that training, I was never going to have to worry about any of that again. It was behind me. I put it in a bag of trash, and it felt great. That was your, you know, flight test engineer. You know, he was a test pilot.
My Neil Armstrong memory is like Garrett. I think the first time I ever met him was, you're in the astronaut office. As he said, you've never flown, and you have all these people coming back that are icons and idols. And so I remember that. But I served for about 8 years as President Obama's administrator of NASA. And one of the early decisions we made was that we were going to retire the shuttle, and we were going to turn to reliance on American industry to produce the spacecraft that would carry us to space and begin to launch humans again from what we call the space coast of Florida. And SpaceX, Garrett's old company, was one of the two winners of the cargo competition, and then they became one of the two winners of the human capsule competition. And we had an organization of retired aviators, people like me, old, and called the Golden Eagles, and we had a convention in Orlando, and one of the things that we set up was a tour of the Kennedy Space Center, and on the front seat of the bus was Neil Armstrong. And the tour was set up so that we would go by the SpaceX facility where they had a Falcon 9 getting ready to launch and just give everybody an opportunity to talk to this part of the space program that people really didn't have a good feel about. And when we pulled up to the hangar, if you will, first person off the bus was Neil Armstrong. And what was amazing about that was the fact that Neil, as an old Apollo astronaut, was really sought after by a lot of people who wanted to fight the president's decision to phase the shuttle out and move to commercial space. And Neil jumped off the bus, and he ran right into the hangar, and he found some of the young engineers, and he introduced himself, not as Neil Armstrong astronaut, but just, you know, I'm Neil Armstrong. And he started asking them about the Falcon 9. And about Dragon, the cargo module. And it was, for me, it was mesmerizing watching this guy who should have been accepting questions from all these starry-eyed people who were just fascinated that they were meeting Neil Armstrong. But the human side of him understood the importance of them knowing that he cared about them and that he thought what they were doing was important. And that is one of my Neil Armstrong experiences that I shall never forget.
So, Nita, I would add one Neil Armstrong story, because I had the pleasure of serving with Neil on the NASA safety panel. And it reminded me that here you have this phenomenal individual who was an American hero, and he donated his time to come in and work hard to make sure that other astronauts would be safe, that he was, as Charlie just alluded to, asking questions and trying to understand and make sure they had thought about all the possibilities, but with a modesty and humility that was very instructive, because clearly he was the smartest person in the room, but you would never know it by the way that he showed up. And I think that that's a great lesson for all of us who are engineers and scientists, which is it's important to keep learning, it's important to keep asking questions.
Definitely. And Neil Armstrong had probably the most historic quote of all time, which is, "One giant leap for mankind." This question is for Dr. Austin. And many people think that the next giant leap for humankind is going to Mars. So in your opinion, why Mars? And what can we learn from Apollo that we can apply to humanity's next journey into the stars?
So I think it's very exciting to recognize that there are still areas that we need to explore. And as you think about the decision process that we as a nation have been involved in about how to get to Mars, what's the right way? Do we go to an asteroid first? How do we get back? It's really daunting that, you know, there is still part of our universe that remains very much an unknown. What surprises me is that when you say, you know, who here wants to volunteer to go to Mars, knowing that we haven't quite figured out how you get back, we get lots of volunteers. So, and I bet some of them are in this room. But I think it's really important to see that we can learn a lot about Mars, but we will also learn a lot about Earth and what we have to do to make Earth sustainable by the things that we learn about Mars in terms of what the challenges are. So I think there's a lot to be discovered in our quest to explore Mars.
And that's a great segue to the next question. This is a personal journey for me, where I had the opportunity to work on the Mars Science Laboratory Curiosity mission that landed in 2012, where we landed a car-sized robot. It was the largest robot that we've landed on the surface to planet to date. But that's still quite far from a technology perspective to landing people on the surface. And so for any of the panelists, if you'd like to give us your perspective on the technology and the societal challenges as a species that we have to overcome to be able to send the next set of people to Mars. How close do you think we are?
I think we're close. I know we're closer than we've ever, than humanity has ever been before. Everybody knows that radiation will be a challenge. I'm comfortable that we understand enough about it that we can make the journey safe. And what we concern ourselves with today is, what is the quality of life going to be like long term for somebody who ventures off to Mars? And, you know, when Garrett and other folks spend 6 months or a year, in the case of Scott Kelly, on the International Space Station, that gives us more data to help us understand all that. But two things that concern me, one of them is, we call it intradecent landing. We don't know how to land anything that heavy on a surface of a body like Mars. Mars doesn't have an atmosphere like Earth. It's really thin, so that means it can't slow the vehicle down as much as we want. So that's the big challenge for us, is trying to figure out, how do we get 20, 30 more metric tons on the surface of a body that doesn't have a thick atmosphere like Earth to slow it down? We use data that we're getting from SpaceX as they come back, and you all may think it's just fancy and all that kind of stuff. NASA thinks it's invaluable. In fact, we really need, for SpaceX as an example, or for Blue Origin, to keep coming back and doing the coming back from supersonic, if not hypersonic speeds, and landing a vehicle to fly again. That may give us some hints on how we land something on Mars. The other thing, which has nothing to do with technology at all, is this thing, the human body. And I wonder what it's going to be like for the first human beings who leave the planet and go, you know, from the moon. Earth was still this marble, this blue marble out there. About a week away from Earth on the way to Mars, the crew is going to look back, and they're going to have to struggle to find this planet. And by the time they get there, they won't be able to find this planet, because it will be smaller than a lot of the other things that they have. Some of them will have kids, and, you know, when you pick up the phone, it's 7 minutes from the time you say hello to your one-year-old child until it gets to them, and then 7 minutes coming back. And psychologically, I think we've got a lot of work to do to help crews understand how you deal with that kind of absence, which could be up to 3 years.
Would you like to add anything else?
That was very well said. I completely agree. I think that technically speaking, we're quite close. It's really a question of having the desire and will to do it, and then the funding, of course, that comes along with that. I think as far as what we learned from Apollo, I think it's important when we go there to know, to have a sustainable reason for why we're going. We were on a tremendous trajectory with Apollo, but a lot of it was predicated on geopolitics. And so having other reasons, I guess, to go and stay. And I think there's some very good ones. I think, first of all, the exploration, as you pointed out, to go there to see a volcano that's 50,000 feet high and to see a canyon that's the size of the entire United States. I mean, can you imagine that? That would be so cool. And then there's the survival imperative, and this is the way, my old boss Elon Musk looks at this is we have all of our eggs in one basket down here. There's been several extinction events. We don't know when the next one's coming. The old adage is, why did the dinosaurs go extinct? It's because they didn't have a space program. So that's kind of tongue in cheek, but it is true that we have a window of opportunity to become a multiplanetary species, and we could do it pretty quickly if we really decided that that's what we want to do. And that would give us a backup. Like right now, it's like having all of our data on one hard drive with no backup.
It's very true. And it's a great segue to my next question, which is about where are we headed as a species from a technology perspective? And the interesting thing is in the 1990s, we had the IT revolution, which has facilitated a whole new sector of the economy with relating to be able to transfer large amounts of information very quickly. And many are now saying that the 2020s are the transportation revolution. And where I work on the Hyperloop is part of that transportation revolution. But it will be Hyperloops, suborbital rockets, and eventually going to Mars. So then the question is, what is the role of the private sector in driving this space race? And can you contrast that to the government-led developments that you've also been a part of? Because that's to all panelists.
So let's talk about the challenge of leveraging the commercial marketplace. The U.S. government puts money in things that no one else is going to fund, but that we need to have capability. And so that's how we got started in the space program. And what we learned and why we made the decision that Charlie alluded to of the fact that we wanted the commercial marketplace to be our mechanism for getting to low Earth orbit is because we felt they could do a better job of it. The government is really constrained in the way in which they buy and acquire things. And the fact that they have to have congressional approval year after year as opposed to being able to start a project, put the funds in place, and continue making progress on that. And you also get the innovation that comes with a commercial marketplace because they look at how to do it cost effectively and they take different kinds of risks. So when you think about, landing, bringing back the first stage of a SpaceX rocket, the government would never have funded that, would never have thought that that was something that they wanted to pursue. So I think the commercial opportunity here is that they will find new and innovative ways of doing it, that they will make it cost effective, that they will think about applications like tourism and just transportation for different reasons than the government would fund it. And so I think we get phenomenal outcomes by engaging the commercial marketplace and allowing those great minds to say, well, we can learn from what the government investment has given us, but there's some other things that we could do as well.
Let me add one quick thing, because what President Austin talked about, I think it's really important for you all to remember, since most of you are students. Don't become commercial ideologues, and let me define what I say there. Don't believe that only industry can advance us in terms of exploration of space and government has no role. As Dr. Austin said, government plays a vital role in paving the way and funding things that private industry will not invest in because there's no guarantee of return. They've got shareholders, they've got to satisfy other kinds of things, so it's really important for government to take that lead. For those of you, though, who are looking for future jobs, be flexible. If you want to work for NASA, but you get a job with SpaceX or Blue Origin or Virgin Galactic, take it. Take it and sample that particular way of doing business, and then when you get a job, when you get an opportunity to come to work for the government, whether it be the Air Force or NASA or anybody else, you'll have something to compare it to. And I can guarantee you, we see young people all the time who go back and forth between the commercial industry and government, because they're trying to figure out which one they want to work in the best, because both have really attractive things to them, but they're very different in some respects.
So I just want to add that one very important thing for everybody there to realize, and this is not very well explained in the media, I think, is that what's going on with SpaceX, for example, with commercial crew and with commercial cargo, but also to some extent Blue Origin, certainly Boeing with their Starliner and Orbital ATK with their cargo vehicle, and Sierra Nevada with the Dream Chaser. People talk about that as new space, commercial space. It's a public-private partnership. Okay, this is not these companies going off and doing this all by themselves. This is been a very fruitful but very equal partnership between the government and NASA and these private companies. And it's not as crazy paradigm shifting as it might seem, to throw a little cold water on it, because hey, NASA and for that matter the Department of Defense always bought their vehicles and worked with private companies that, like the Saturn V we're about to watch blast off, was not built by NASA engineers and in a NASA factory. It was built by Rocketdyne, McDonnell Douglas, I guess, North American Rockwell. So those are private companies. The thing that's changed a little bit is the contracting mechanism, as President Austin referred to. And that's, it's kind of boring, right? It's going from a cost plus to a firm fixed price. And it's like, and as far as the roles and responsibilities, there's a slight shift on the spectrum of who does what. That's it. I mean, you're not going to sell too many newspapers or get too many clicks on your website if you talk about that. So it's much more sexy to talk about new space and, you know, all this. But the truth is that what we're doing is not altogether different from how it was done during Apollo. It's a slight change, and there's one big difference is that there is a possibility, so North American couldn't go off and make another Saturn V and go do a tourist flight around the moon. But in this new mechanisms, we own the intellectual property in the private sector, so we can go do those kinds of things, which opens up new markets and spurs on new innovation. But in reality, it's not all that different.
And I think the other thing, which is very interesting to people who want to become astronauts, and a lot of the people who study aerospace engineering are motivated by the ability to potentially travel in space one day, is that because we now have this private access to space, it may actually change the way in which people become astronauts. And so everyone here would love to hear about your personal journey becoming an astronaut, and do you think that now there's a different way to become an astronaut because of the now commercial access to space?
There's already a different way of becoming an astronaut. You know, when I became a test pilot, you could go to Edwards Air Force Base, to the Air Force Test Pilot School, Patuxent River, Maryland, to the Navy's Test Pilot School, or you could go overseas to either the French Test Pilot School or the British Test Pilot School. Today you can go to Mojave, right up not far from here, and you can go to the U.S., I think it's called the U.S. Test Pilot School. It's a civilian institution that models itself after the Air Force's test pilot school at down at Edwards, and it is now producing test pilots who go into industry. One of the first pilots for Virgin Galactic was a graduate of the U.S. test pilot school, not a military test pilot school. If you look at astronauts today, they're totally different from the days of Apollo, where pilots dominated. One of the astronauts young lady getting ready to go to space, to the International Space Station, is a microbiologist, and her passion is extremophiles. So she spent her professional life in Antarctica scraping ice from under the Arctic ice sheet to find microbes. She's been diving around thermal vents, the beginnings of volcanoes, scraping up stuff, lava, to find extremophiles, forms of life that can exist in very, very extreme conditions, which is exactly what we're looking for Mars. So we're looking for people who have had these extreme experiences as students and young people and professionals. It's a totally different world for the group of astronauts today from what it was when Garrett and I first came in.
I think the technology is changing as well, which creates new opportunities. So the vehicles we're building today are much more automated than the vehicles we flew. When we flew in the shuttle, if one pump failed, The shuttle didn't have sophisticated enough software, for example, to turn on the backup pump. You actually had to, or the backup controller, you had to flip switches and do it all manually. That's all done by the computers now. So the skill sets that are required for, and is part of the requirements actually for our vehicles that we're building for the commercial crew program, is that the skill sets, you don't have to be a test pilot. You can be a scientist, an engineer, or somebody who studied microbes in Antarctica and still fly these vehicles. So that does create possibilities for a much larger segment of the population to go to space and be part of this. And that and certainly as we look towards some of the space tourism stuff, that is with that in mind.
Let me add one thing that we may not get to, but I want to make sure we do, and that's the aspect of international collaboration and cooperation. Those of you who are students at USC, you are perfectly situated. USC is a mini United Nations. Not sure how many of you appreciate that. That's the way space is today. It is almost never a time, in fact, there is never a time, over the last 18 years or so, there's not been one second. So for any of you who are 18 years or younger, you have not existed, you have not taken a breath when there haven't been human beings orbiting this planet on the International Space Station, and it's always been an international crew. Now, every once in a while, we'll go down to two people, a Russian and an American, but there's always at least a Russian and an American. Think about that, given the geopolitical situation in the world today. So international collaboration is absolutely critical for the things that we want to do in the future.
Absolutely. And diversity of backgrounds, diversity of all kinds, diversity of thought leads to more innovative solutions. And so that's a good connection to my next question for Dr. Austin. Dr. Austin is a hero of mine. She's a leader in the aerospace sector. But sadly, Dr. Austin and I are a rare breed in aerospace. I think women probably only represent about 15% of the field. Only just a few years back, we had the movie Hidden Figures, which I think was very motivational to women and people of underrepresented groups all over the country and all over the world. But then when we look at the movie that we're going to watch tonight, the title is First Man. And so that may be confusing to some young girls that, well, if it says First Man, does that mean that space travel is not for women? So what can we do, Dr. Austin, both me and you and everyone in this room, to ensure that there are more women and people of underrepresented groups in the STEM fields?
So the first thing I would share is that I did not know about Katherine Johnson when I was growing up and when I was in engineering school. And so I was delighted when this amazing woman told her story and she received a medal from the President of the United States. And you think, how could you be in this industry and not know about this story? But it's true. So I think one of the important things that we have to do, Anita, is make sure that young women very early in their careers are exposed to the fact that there are women doing amazing things in science and engineering and technology, and to help them understand that by enjoying math and pursuing math, that that will enable them to make the choice about what kinds of career options they want to have. So I would applaud Viterbi, because I believe that this year, Yannis, we accepted more women into the engineering program. 45%. So, you know, Viterbi is on a mission here, and I really salute that, because women need to see other women in their classes. Young men need to see women in their classes so that when they are putting teams together and they are trying to solve hard problems and they're looking for creative ideas and new perspectives, that they are surrounding themselves with a team of people that look and are very diverse. Diverse in discipline, diverse in thought process, diverse in approaches to solving problems, because that is what gives us by far the best solutions. There are no problems that a single discipline can solve for us. We have to figure out how to put all of our collective knowledge together. And why in the world would we take 50% of our population and tell them that your ideas don't count? We have to find a way to reach out to everybody and have them reach their full potential. So we're already on it.
Here, here. So we're almost at the end of our session, so I have one final question for all three panelists, and you can use this also as your closing statements, and this is something which is super important to me as a massive science fiction fan, is that are we ready as a species to move out of low Earth orbit? And how can we use the new technologies that we're developing in multiple sectors, whether it's artificial gravity or virtual reality, as a means of solving these challenges from a societal perspective, from a psychological perspective, and from a technology perspective? Are we ready to leave low Earth orbit?
Wow. So we will leave low Earth orbit because I think you can choose to take two disparate views of our shared future. You can either be a pessimist and say that we are going to, our civilization is going to regress and we're going to be consumed by squabbles on Earth, by warfare, we're going to destroy this planet, we're going to pollute it. There's all kinds of, there's plenty of movies out there, unlike the one we're going to watch tonight, that have a dystopian view of where we're heading. And it's not hard when you read the newspaper every day to think that maybe that's possible. I choose to be an optimist. I think that we will find a way. We have always found a way. And we will find a way to overcome these little disagreements, and we will find a way to work together collaboratively like we've done on the space station. Even in the midst of all this turmoil, the working relationships on the space station between the Russians and the Americans are really excellent. And so I think that's a model of, it's the Star Trek future, right? I think that's a much more hopeful future. And I think we will get there. So if you take the optimist view that we are heading towards a shared collaborative future, peaceful future together as humans, of course we're going to leave low Earth orbit. We're going to have cities on Mars. We're going to have landers on Europa. All that's going to happen. It's inevitable. It's just a matter of us rising above our differences.
I would add that we're going to leave low Earth orbit because we're going to discover that there are amazing things that we can do once we get beyond low Earth orbit. And even if we just go to geostationary orbit, which gives us the advantage of being able to be over the same position on the Earth continuously, we haven't leveraged what we can do from remote sensing and communications that geometry gives us an advantage. So even in the interim, as we try to consider about moving to Mars, there's a lot that we can learn and can gain as we reach far in our explorations and be willing to look at, what's in the possible. So absolutely, got to go.
My dad was a high school civics and social studies teacher who was my football coach. My mother was a librarian. So I'm going to give you their answer. We definitely are going to leave low Earth orbit, and we're going to do it because of you. You're not going to tolerate us staying around in low Earth orbit. You've already demonstrated that. You are not going to tolerate, as Dr. Austin said, 50% of the population not having a say in what we do. But it's really important for all of you to recognize the fact that, the future is yours to define. It is up to you all to determine what we're going to do. And I cannot conceive of the students in this audience sitting back and allowing us to just lull around in low Earth orbit or to lull around where we don't have diverse and inclusive groups. I think you're going to demand it. So that's where my confidence is in you, and that's why I think we're really going to do it.
Well, that does conclude our panel, and I think everyone in this room should be incredibly proud to be part of USC, and we're all USC alumni. And I think the message of the evening is that you can build the future that you imagine. So thank you, the panelists, and thank you, everyone.
Thanks for listening. Subscribe to our podcast and follow us on Facebook.